Amen. Well, go ahead and have a seat. It's good to see you guys are here tonight. Remember, next Wednesday, we won't be doing Need to Know because we have Together. It's always the last Wednesday of the month, so we'll be having a... What kind of meal are we having, Jerry? You remember?
Barbecue.
So definitely come back next Wednesday at 6:30 for a great night of Together. Tonight, and when I printed the little handouts that you have, I was hurrying because we had a meeting this morning and I had a lunch appointment, and so I didn't put a title on the top of it, but it should be called, you can write it across the top, it should be called something like Bible reading and prayer. We're really talking about the disciplines of the Christian life, the kinds of things that we do to help us in our walk with the Lord. And just to get the feel for that, turn over to Philippians chapter 2. Really important verse that Paul wrote to church in Philippi, his favorite church. Philippians chapter 2, verses 12 and 13. He says, "Therefore, my beloved, as you have always obeyed, not as in my presence only, but now much more in my absence, work out your own salvation with fear and trembling. For it is God who works in you both to will and to do for his good pleasure." And then he says, "Do all things without complaining and disputing, that you may become blameless and harmless, children of God without fault in the midst of a crooked and perverse generation among whom you shine as lights in the world." Now, we know that salvation comes to us by grace through faith, and Paul says in Ephesians 2, it's not of works lest anyone should boast. And yet, he says here, work out your own salvation with fear and trembling. Take it seriously because God is working in you. And this is sometimes it's a challenge to people to grasp this. And a lot of times, pastors and theologians will say, well, he's not talking about salvation here, he's talking about sanctification. And then they say the word salvation can mean what we call salvation. It can also mean sanctification or the process of becoming holy, and it can also mean glorification as to when you go to heaven, because salvation is used to refer to all three of those. But I'm really nervous to just say this is sanctification, it's not salvation. Because Paul had he uses the term sanctification and glorification plenty of times. So I think when you take something that he says, you shouldn't take a word that he could have used and then presume that, okay, what he really meant was sanctification. At the very least, we make artificial divisions in our relationship with God that Paul doesn't make, and Jesus doesn't make, really, and I don't think that God wants us to make. So we shouldn't think of salvation as one thing, and then our daily lives, the process of God working in us, as being something different than that. Salvation is something that we need constantly. It's really, in the Scriptures, it's referred to way more as a process than it is as a decision. And I think in our evangelical culture, with revivalism over the last 150 years, it's a big emphasis has been put on salvation as a decision, but you do not see that in the Scriptures. Salvation is seen as, hey, this is God's rescue program, and it is a process. There certainly is a time when you open yourself up to that process, and it's not incorrect to suggest that that is being saved. But salvation's always in the Bible seen as an ongoing process in the present tense. And so what he is saying is not, okay, you're saved, now let's talk about sanctification or how you become more holy. He uses the word salvation, and I'm never comfortable taking what the Word of God says when the Holy Spirit inspired the writer of Scripture to say it just that way, and he had all kinds of other words he could have used, but he used this one. To me, I think we should look at this as this is our relationship with God. And he says, you need to work it out because God is working it in. Work out your own salvation with fear and trembling. Take your progress seriously because of the fact that God is working in our lives. Now, I don't know everything that there is to say about that, but the reason I even bring the scripture up is because we need to understand if we have a relationship with God, then we need to take it seriously and we need to actually work on that relationship. Again, I'll make it clear, Ephesians 2, 8, and 9, you don't work to earn salvation, okay? There's nothing that I can do to save myself, but there's a lot that I can do to work with God as he's working in my life and I'm working it out. There's a lot of obedience. There's a lot of discipline in my life that can enhance that process that God wants to do. He wants to work with us. He wants to work in us and on us, but with us as well. And so things go much better in the life of a saved person in our salvation when we say, okay, I want to work on this with you. It's like if you have a kid or, you know, a niece or nephew or whatever, little kids love to work with you on something. If they think they're working, you know, and helping, a lot of times I know when my kids were smaller, they wanted to help me carry something. And all that meant was they would get on one end of it, I would get on the other end, and I had to lift the whole thing with my wrists and forearms and make them think that they were helping. That's kind of what God does with us, I suppose. But we get to work with him, and we shouldn't be so focused on, no, it's by grace through faith, that then we just get lazy. Because Paul says, no, you better take this seriously. You need to work on your relationship with God. This is something that involves effort on your part. And we shouldn't shy away from it. Our effort doesn't make us worth salvation. It doesn't make us more saved in a way, but in a way, maybe it does. Because as we grow closer to him, we certainly see him working in different areas of our lives. He wants to save everything about me. Not just save me from hell. He wants to rescue me in the way I live my life. And so he says, hey, work on that. And so that's an important verse. Now, see, that means that there are certain things I do that can cooperate with God, that he's working things into my life, and I can do certain things that help all of that to be worked out, that help me to be able to grow, to be able to become closer to him, to become more effective, to look more like him. And these are what are often called the spiritual disciplines. And don't be afraid of that term, because there are some kind of wacko people that really make a big deal about the spiritual disciplines and make them all mystical and everything. It's really quite simple. There are things that we do, that we discipline ourselves to do, that helps us as we work on the process of salvation as it's worked into our lives and as we are working out. It's spiritual discipline is just another way of saying there are things you do to be obedient. You do what he tells you to do, not so that you will he will like you more, or that so you will be better thought of or whatever. It's just like any activity in life. If you don't practice, you're not going to be very good at it. You look at the Clippers. But no, I mean, there are things that you do that you can become more effective if you work on it. And if it's like it in every other area of life, why, if you're married, if you don't work on your marriage, it doesn't get any better. If you don't work at your profession, you won't be more effective. If you don't practice all sorts of things, you're going to be, you know, less than what you could be if you practice it and you work on it. And so spiritual disciplines are simply things that we do because even if I don't feel like it right now, I know this is good for me if I do it. Now, the two primary spiritual disciplines that we're going to talk about tonight, I'll mention some others at the end if I have time, but are the spiritual discipline of scripture reading and of prayer. And those are the two, I think, the two most important spiritual disciplines for us to obey God in, because it's a way that we exercise our lives in a way that we are drawn closer to becoming who he is making us to be. We actually cooperate with him as we do this. Now, turn over to Psalm 119. It's the longest chapter in the Bible, and it's one of my favorites. And I'm really going to, we don't have the time to go through this whole chapter. We'll look at a few things, and then I'm going to give you an assignment for you to do. That if you do it, you are taking seriously your salvation, and you are working it out by doing this exercise that I'm going to give you. If you don't do it, you'll miss out, that's all. Psalm 119, it's a incredibly creative passage of Scripture. It notice that before verse 1, it says Aleph, and it has a little, probably in your Bible, it should say Aleph and has a little Hebrew A. And then down after the 8th verse, it says Beth, and it has the letter for B in Hebrew, and then Gimel, Daleth, Hey, and so on, all the way through the Hebrew alphabet. You don't get this in English, but in Hebrew, this thing was so brilliantly constructed. Somebody had to work on it in an amazing way, because when it says Aleph, which is the A in Hebrew, it's the first letter of the alphabet, every one of the first 8 verses starts with a word that begins with the letter A. So it's like, try to think of 8 words that start with A. Apple, Adam, ape, you know, you have to think a little bit. But this all makes sense, and it's this brilliant construction, because then when you get to verse 9, the Beth section, all of those 8 verses start with the letter B, the letter Beth in Hebrew. And on down through, Gimel, Daleth, Hey, Wah, the Hebrew alphabet is 8 verses of each letter, and each verse in the section starts with that letter of the Hebrew alphabet. Try doing that in English and see how hard would you have to work to be creative just to come up with something silly and goofy, much less to come up with one of the richest passages in the Bible. Now, God inspired this, but somebody worked on it really hard. It's a masterpiece that, you know, again, without even, you can read it and go, it's a masterpiece before you even start noticing. What are these groups of 8 verses all the way through in that weird word before it? When you see that, it's like, whoa. Now, the theme of Psalm 119, and the reason I'm bringing it up, is basically Psalm 119 is all about the benefits of reading the Bible and meditating on it. And it's also creative because it doesn't say, you know, here's why you need to read the Bible, and the Bible does this, and the Bible does that, and the Bible does the other thing. In this chapter, he comes up with a whole bunch of different words for the Bible, but it's all talking about the Bible, and it calls it different things. And if you read through this whole chapter, you will see a whole bunch of reasons as to why we study the Bible, why it's important for us to exercise the discipline of Bible reading. So we'll just pick up a few here. In verse 1, blessed are the undefiled in the way who walk in the law of the Lord. So the Bible here is the law of the Lord. It makes them happy, and they become less defiled. Oh, verse 7, I will praise you with uprightness of heart when I learn your righteous judgments. So it's also God's judgments are considered his law or the word of God, and it makes your heart right. It makes it set right. Verse 9, how can a young man cleanse his way? By taking heed according to your word. Reading the Bible has a way of cleaning you up. You know, when you're messed up, it helps you to live right and to be clean, to know that you're forgiven. Verse 14, I've rejoiced in the way of your testimonies. Another word for Bible here is testimonies, as much as in all riches. It gives you joy and it makes you feel rich as you do that. Verse 18, open my eyes that I may see wondrous things from your law. Our eyes are open. We see things that are amazing from his law, which is, again, his word. Verse 24, your testimonies also are my delight and my counselors. You read God's word, it gives you advice, and you experience delight. There are things you discover that you're like, whoa, that's amazing. Verse 25, my soul clings to the dust. Revive me according to your word. His word actually brings life into us when we think we're just dying. Verse 28, my soul melts from heaviness. Strengthen me according to your word. Your soul is melting. It's weighed down. It's burdened. We get strength from the word of God. Verse 32, I will run the course of your commandments, another word for the Bible, for you shall enlarge my heart. Your heart actually expands from spending time in the word of God. And the last one we'll look at, verses 36 and 37, he says, incline my heart to your testimonies and not to covetousness. Turn away my eyes from looking at worthless things and revive me in your way. So he says, you will be able to move away from the deceptive idea that stuff is worth something as you read his word. You're delivered from that covetousness, from that materialism that can so destroy you. So you get kind of the idea of what I'm talking about. Your assignment, should you choose to accept it, is to go through Psalm 119. And if you write in your Bible, you can actually just do this, you know, write in your Bible. But if you don't like that, you can do notes on a piece of paper or something instead. But make a list or choose all of the different words in Psalm 119 that refer to the Bible. Because when you see all the different words that refer to it as testimonies, as his law, as his commandments, and, you know, as his word, all these things each show us a little different aspect of the Bible. So, for instance, if you're going through here, go through and make a square around every word that is another synonym for the Bible. And then the other thing is, you can make a circle around things that are a fringe benefit of reading the Bible. Like, why does God want us to read the Bible? And you will see. I mean, we've seen a bunch of them, but there are a lot more. So if you, this, I'm challenging you to do this as a discipline, as a spiritual discipline. Take this chapter and come up with the different words for the Bible that are used here and come up with all the benefits of reading it. And if you do that, you will benefit greatly from that study, for sure. And it'll be like, whoa, I can't believe how much of it there is. I just wanted to mention, and it's mentioned in Psalm 119 a lot, meditation on the Bible. Meditation is something more than just reading the Bible and going through it. In Psalm 1, David says, oh, how happy is the man who walks not in the counsel of the ungodly, or stands in the way of sinners, or sits in the seat of the scornful. His delight is in the law of the Lord, and in his law he meditates day and night. And then he goes on and says the benefits, that he'll be like a tree planted by the rivers of water, brings forth fruit in its season. His leaf won't wither, and whatever he does will prosper. Did you know that the Bible promises that if you meditate on his word, that you will become successful in whatever it is that you do? That's a wild promise, but it's a promise. It helps because the word of God gives us so much guidance. We have all those benefits. So what does it mean to meditate on the word of God? It's a word that means to really run it over and over in your head. I think the world talks a lot about meditation, and the idea in the world is that you should just try to make your mind empty. Or they start out with mindfulness. Something comes into your mind, think about that. Notice, oh, I'm thinking that. Oh, now I'm thinking this. Now I'm thinking the other thing. But the ultimate expression of that is to be able to blank your mind out and do nothing. That's not what God expects us to do. That's why we meditate on his word, on what he says. But some of the, and you know, nowadays they find out that meditation actually can work more effectively than medication when it comes to certain illnesses and certainly a lot of anxiety and things like that, that meditation actually helps. Well, the reason is we are designed to be able to shut out all of that crazy activity that's flying by us and really get to focus. We are our most healthy when we are able to focus. It's one of the horrible things about the way that our society causes people to have an attention deficit. don't believe the lie that attention deficit is just something that you get. It's like, no. No, we create it in our culture. We create it by throwing too much data at people, and it's not a healthy thing at all. But meditating on God's word is being able to take a small chunk of it. And the same word is used for a cow that chews its cud, just like it chews and chews and chews and spits it out, eats it again. It's just mulling it over. So reading the Bible fast, like we, some of us a few years ago in the fourth quarter of the year, we read through the entire Bible in 3 months. That was a really cool thing. I loved that. But sometimes also, if I want to meditate, I'm just going to take a little piece of the Bible and I'm going to go, I'm going to carry that with me today. And every chance I get, if I'm sitting at a red light, I'm going over that phrase or that verse. And you might go, but wait, how will I know when the light turns green? You'll know. But so meditation, like for instance, this Sunday we're in John chapter 14. John 14, 6 is that amazing verse where Jesus said, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father except by me. So here's how I might meditate on John 14, 6 for weeks. I just look at it and I go, Jesus is saying, I am the way. And so all today, when I get a chance and as I'm thinking about it, I'm remembering that he is the way. He's the one. He's the path. He's the road I want to be on. He's the one I want to be walking with. And I see how many things that happen in my life that can pull me back to that simple phrase that he's the way. And when I get some downtime, or I might just during my lunch, if I'm by myself, just really think about and mull over and chew on the fact that he's the way. Because that, you could meditate on that for a week and still see new ramifications for it. And then you go on, the truth. What does it mean that he's the truth? He's the truth, so he doesn't lie to me. So now I'm looking in my life on that day or on those days and looking for things that are lies and going, on the other hand, he is the truth. And I'm thinking about things that he has told me in his word that I believe. And so I'm just meditating on that chunk. You can do that with any scripture. The amazing thing about the scripture is it's just not about getting through the stuff. Every word of scripture was breathed by God. And the word of God is alive and powerful and sharper than any two-edged sword. It's not about, okay, let me get to the point. Let me organize myself. It's one reason why I'm not, you know, completely crazy about Bible studies that are all geared toward you reading the stuff and writing down the answers and sharing your answers. That's a super low level of thinking. A higher level of thinking goes beyond that and applies something to life. It's why the questions that I write for our small groups, I don't write a question like, well, what does this verse say about that? And you look at the verse and you write it down. That's a way to make yourself stupider, more stupid. You know, we need to elevate our thinking to a higher level, and meditation does that. Because we don't just rush right through it. I'm the way, the truth, and life. No one comes to the Father except by me. Okay, what's next? We live in the text. We realize that, and I fully believe this, if you only read John 14, 6 all year, you would find things from John 14, 6 that I never thought of. Because I haven't read it for a year. I've read it many, many times, but so often I want to get on to what's next. And meditation is saying, I'm going to just stop right here. And I'm going to take, if it's true that as Jesus says in John 17, 17, that not one jot or tittle, the basic breathing marks in Hebrew won't pass away before everything is fulfilled. That means he picks every word for a reason. And to get into those words and just really savor them is, it helps us to realize how rich God's word is. And so I encourage you in your reading to also devote some time to just meditating. Just go sit in a park and just think about, you know, a part of a verse or a whole verse. You know, it can be like John 3:16, you know, most of you maybe memorized it when you were a little kid, but how much have you thought about what that actually says? For God so loved. Not that he loved, that he so loved. It's like this amazing thing. And he loved his own people, yeah, but he loved the world. The world. It's the only world that there is. It's a definite article, you know, that he gave. It wasn't just that he came, he gave. And I mean, you can take a verse like that and you can live in it for a long time, and it has power. And as you read over Psalm 119, when you see meditation mentioned, that's what he's talking about. It's like just focus on a small part and allow that to go over in your mind. Now, one reason why Bible memorization, which I have down here as another aspect of this discipline, is that when you memorize the scripture, then you don't have to keep referring back to it. You program it, you know, into your mind. Over in Deuteronomy chapter 6, when in what we call the Shema, one of the Jews' favorite prayers that they pray regularly, where he says, you know, hear, O Israel. The Shema in Hebrew just means hear. Hear, O Israel, the Lord our God, the Lord is one, and you shall love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your mind. And then he says, and you teach this to your kids, and you hang it on your doorpost, and you tie it on your wrist, you have, you know, little index cards that you carry with you. You completely program that. We had a guy who was a janitor at Calvary, who he's a pastor now up in Northern California, but he used to stick Bible verses all over the walls and everything, and I thought, that's really annoying. But then I realized, what an amazing thing to do, that it's like the Word of God is right there. You might think that, yeah, I wish I had memorized verses when I was a kid, because now I don't memorize things very well. Welcome to meditation. You spend enough time on a verse, you will know that verse, and you will memorize it. And again, it's a discipline that will actually pay off in benefits to your soul. Because now, if you want to meditate, and it also comes into your prayers and everything else, the more scriptures that you have programmed into your mind, and again, also in Psalm 119:11, thy word have I hid in my heart that I might not sin against you. This is something that we do that helps us to reprogram our brains, reading and memorizing. I had a friend who, when he came to the Lord, he really couldn't read at all. He had bluffed his way all the way through school and became a plasterer. And then, you know, when people made fun of him, he would beat them up. And he became the best fighter that I've ever known. He was just an amazing fighter. And I got talking to him at a karate tournament. I took him out of the bleachers and talked to him about the Lord. And he ended up praying and accepting the Lord. Today, he's a security guy at another Calvary. But, you know, I saw him begin to grow when somebody gave him a children's Bible. And he began to just sound out the words. And he taught himself to read from the Bible itself. And now when he calls me, he's just like, oh man, you're not going to believe it. I read this verse. And, you know, the verse says this. And he gets some kind of, it's definitely the Chris Romero version of the verse. But it's like, it's so amazing. Because he reads, and the Word of God did that to him. And it's actually programmed into his heart, and he remembers it. And now when, you know, they had a guy a while back who came into their church and was attacking a pastor and stuff, Chris is like telling him verses as he's, you know, putting him down on the ground and choking him out, and he's like sharing with them. I remember the first time he was just a brand new Christian, and he came to me. I was at the back door with Pastor Chuck, and Chris came up, and he goes, he's all excited. He goes, Dave, I shared with some guy. And I go, Chris, what happened? And he goes, oh, this guy was over there cussing at his girlfriend and just being really mean to her. And I go, Chris, what'd you do? He goes, well, I told him, Jesus doesn't want you talking to her like that. And he goes, what are you going to do about it? And I jumped over that little fence, and I back-knuckled him in the face. He's bleeding. He's asking his girlfriend for forgiveness. He's, like, praying with me and everything. So he's come a long way since then. Pastor Romaine put a rule on him that if you tackle anyone to the ground, it has to be off the property. So it was like the next day they're out in the divider strip on Fairview. He's got some guy on the ground. But I saw what God's word did in his life, and it's amazing. It ended up, God not only worked in his life, healed his marriage, did all sorts of amazing things for him. That's what the word of God does. Now, I put some suggested verses that I would say, this is a good place to start if you haven't memorized verses in a long time. These are some of the really important ones. John 3:16 and 17, I just mentioned. The Romans road, Romans 3:23, you know, for all have sinned and come short of the glory of God. Romans 6:23, the wages of sin is death, the gift of God is eternal life. Romans 5:8, but God showed his love toward us, and that while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us. Romans 10:9 and 10, if you confess with your mouth the Lord Jesus, believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead, you'll be saved. And, you know, John 14:6, I'm the way, the truth, and the life. 1 John 1:9, if we confess our sins, he is faithful and just to forgive us our sins, cleanse us from all unrighteousness. Proverbs 3, 5, and 6, trust in the Lord with all your heart and lean not on your own understanding. In all your ways acknowledge him and he will direct your path. All of these verses are such important verses that, and I just jotted these down because I'm like, which verses do I think about all the time? Which verses am I just like, wow, that's exactly what I need to hear right now? You know, Philippians 4:13, I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. So this is a small list of those verses. And at the end of the list, if you ever want to memorize a chapter, which is really cool because you get it into context, Isaiah 53 is my favorite chapter of the Bible. And I memorized it when I was a little kid. And I still just, you know, if I'm just somewhere and I don't have anything to do, I just go through that chapter, and it's just so, it makes me cry every time, but it's just so powerful. And the 23rd Psalm, just such a, the Shepherd Psalm, so beautiful that I bet I quote it every week, at least in my own mind and heart. So if you want to discipline yourself in the Word of God, then read it, meditate on it, and memorize it. And those will pay off in huge dividends for you. And again, you might go, man, it'll take me forever to memorize just one verse. Well, it won't take you forever, but it might take you a couple of weeks to really memorize one verse. And guess what? Now you know one verse more than you used to. It's not about, and don't think, man, Pastor Dave, when you're speaking, you just like say these verses as they come into your mind. It's like, yeah, but I've been memorizing the Bible since I was 2 years old. And it's a lifetime of that. It definitely comes, even though my memory is not what it used to be, but at least I've got stuff in there to come out. I knew a guy who was a missionary, just an amazing guy, and he ended up losing his mental capacities. He had Alzheimer's, and he was in a home, and he wouldn't recognize his own kids. But you could start a Bible verse and he could finish it. And you could start a Christian hymn and he could sing the rest of it. It's like, I think it's the last thing that you leave, that you lose. The Apostle John, supposedly in the church in Ephesus, after John got off Patmos, out of exile, and he's an old man, over 100 years old, and he's in church, church history says they would carry him up in his chair and set him in front of the church. And he would just say, beloved, let us love one another. And then they would take him back to his seat. 1 John 4:7. You know, and if you know, and some of these verses have songs attached to them. So, you know, a lot of us memorize 1 John 4:7 and 8 by saying, beloved, let us love one another, for love is of God. There's all kinds of ways to put something in your head. The point is, this is something that takes discipline and it takes effort and it pays off in huge dividends, and you will never be sorry. You'll never go, God, I hate it. I have so much of God's word in my head. I just can't. No, it'll help you to put everything else into perspective. So besides the reading of the Bible, the other spiritual discipline that the Bible talks a lot about is the discipline of prayer. The place of prayer in the life of a believer, I have for this next subheading. And you know, we can go through, I could go through a bunch of these verses, but You might remember the story in the Old Testament of Elijah, and James mentions it too. It's like the guy prayed and it stopped raining for 3.5 years, and he prayed again and it rained. He came to Mount Baal and he challenged the prophets of Baal to a duel, and he let them go first, and they're all desperate and they can't bring fire from heaven. And he like hams it up by the sacrifice is there, but he's like, let's just dump water all over it. Because he's figuring either God's going to burn it or he isn't. Water's not going to stop God. So he's, you know, he had been making fun of these guys all morning. Now he puts all this water, and then he just goes, okay, God, you know who these people are, and it'd sure be nice if you could burn this sacrifice and show the people who you are. And after God did that, all the people said, the Lord, he is God, the Lord, he is God. All because a guy like him prayed. And you remember the story of Daniel. When Daniel had this disciplined life of prayer in his closet, but with a window open. And he knew he was threatened. We don't want to see you praying in your window anymore. And if you are, you'll be thrown to the lions. He's like, sorry, I'm praying still. And he just did. You look at David and, you know, how you read the Psalms, they're full of David's prayers. David was a man of intense and passionate prayer. Really, throughout the Old Testament, you see the place of prayer in a huge way. Throughout the New Testament, you see it as well. You realize that prayer was an important part of the life of Jesus. Now, one passage that, let's just go ahead and turn over there, Matthew 6, because this is the greatest section, the most that we are taught about prayer in the entire Bible. We know from in Luke that, you know, and maybe this was on a different occasion, but they saw Jesus praying and the disciples were like, teach us to pray. And he shared what we call the Lord's Prayer. But here it's a part of, and it's interesting too, people are like, I don't like praying the Lord's Prayer because that's vain repetition. It's only vain if you don't mean it. Apparently, Jesus, on either 2 or 3 occasions, actually, when he told them how to pray, he prayed the Lord's Prayer verbatim. And so he didn't mind people praying it more than once. And I find sometimes, I personally like singing it, you know, because there's a song that goes to it, Our Father, which art in heaven. We used to sing it at the end of church all the time at Calvary Costa Mesa, until Chuck heard Crystal Hall sing the song, The Lord Bless Thee, the Levitical blessing, and then he would kind of alternate, and we used to alternate, and now people like that, The Lord Bless Thee so much, you know, that's just what I do. But you know, it was an important part of what they did was this praying, and so here in Matthew 6, beginning with verse 5, he says, when you pray, don't be like the hypocrites, for they love to pray standing in the synagogues and on the corners of the streets that they may be seen by men. Assuredly, I say to you, they have their reward. Don't pray in front of people for the attention that you'll get. But you, when you pray, go into your room. And when you have shut your door, pray to your Father who is in the secret place, and your Father who sees in secret will reward you openly. And when you pray, don't use vain repetitions like the heathen do. Just don't go on and on and on. They think they'll be heard for their many words. So no public prayers. We're talking about private prayers. No long prayers. We're talking about short prayers. And he says, you don't want to be like them. Your Father knows what you need. So in this manner, therefore, pray, Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name, beginning with praise to his identity. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. A prayer of submission that I just want you to do what you do, God. Give us this day our daily bread. That'll be enough. Forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. Forgive us the same way we forgive others. Do you really like praying that? You better forgive others if you're going to pray that. I a lot of times I just go, God, please forgive me better than I forgive other people. Don't lead us into temptation, But deliver us from the evil one, for yours is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. And he's like, I know I got your attention. If you forgive men their trespasses, your heavenly Father will also forgive you. But if you do not forgive men their trespasses, neither will your Father forgive your trespasses. That's, you know, and I always say, that's pretty serious. That God will only forgive you if you forgive other people. And I could easily make a, you know, some way around it, but, well, I'm sure what he's saying is this or that, but I just as soon stick with what he said. Again, he knows what he's saying when he says it. Do I believe that you will go to hell if there's someone that you haven't forgiven? No, I don't believe that. There's enough verses that make that clear. But at the same time, Jesus himself said, if you don't forgive others, you won't be forgiven. What's that mean? Well, I mean, for me, maybe it's the idea that if you know that you've been forgiven, it should make you more gracious and more forgiving to others. It ought to work that way. It's probably talking about in general. It's not saying that there might be an exception or something. I don't know, but it just says it. So I'm not gonna, you know, defend Jesus by twisting his words. It says what it says. But you go on, and a lot of these verses, we don't have time to look them up, but in Mark 6, verse 46, it says that Jesus went off to a mountain to pray. Jesus did this often. In one place it says, as was his custom. He would stay up late or get up early and go off somewhere else in order to pray. Couldn't Jesus have prayed in his bedroll? Sure, I'm sure he did, actually. But he made a specific effort as a discipline to go away. And there's something powerful about that. When I go off somewhere specifically to pray, it helps me to focus more rather than if I'm going to do other things and, hey, I'll try to get some time for prayer or, you know, I pray in my study at home. I pray in my office here a lot. I pray a lot. But at the same time, it's different when I actually go out in nature and have no other agenda than I'm here to pray. Jesus did that. He went to a mountain to pray. Luke 6:12 says that he prayed all night. Now again, Jesus' prayers that he did publicly, they were really short. He even told us, don't pray long prayers. Don't pray so that you could show off for others. Here's a template. Pray like this. And then he goes and prays all night because he's with the Father. He's doing that. And what he had to talk to him about was that important. Luke 9:28 talks about him taking Peter, James, and John off to a mountain to pray. So he not only went off by himself to do it, he took them. And we see when he took them to pray, it wasn't so they could all hold hands and sing kumbaya and pray together. It was like he would go, you guys pray, and I'm going to go pray. And partly the disciples were there to stand guard to keep people from bugging Jesus while he was praying. Luke 11:1, it said that Jesus was praying and the disciples said to him, teach us to pray. Matthew 26:36 is where he was in the Garden of Gethsemane in agony. And what was he doing the night before he died? He was out there praying in a garden. And I think that's important. But throughout the rest of the New Testament, we see this discipline of prayer continued. In Acts 2, verse 9, that's the story of where Peter was at the house of Simon the Tanner there in Joppa, and it says he went up on the roof to pray. And it was while he was up on the roof that he had this vision, and he knew that God wanted him to go to a Gentile's house, Cornelius, a centurion, and go and preach the gospel to them and that they would receive the Holy Spirit just like the Jewish Christians had. That happened while he was praying. Romans 8:26, and Romans 8 is one of the greatest chapters in the Bible for sure, but one of the things that is clear there is that when we pray and we don't know what to say, the Holy Spirit helps us. The Holy Spirit aids us to be able to pray. So therefore, prayer is important enough that the Holy Spirit helps. We also see that Jesus intercedes for us. Now, I think in Romans 8, when Paul says that he intercedes for us with groanings that are too deep for words, To me, I think most likely that that is what we would call praying in the spirit or praying in tongues, where it's like, I don't know what else to say, and so I let my mouth go, and somehow my prayer is ascending and the spirit's transferring it. And so to me, that's something that I really treasure and value. But I'm not going to say that, you know, if you don't do that, you're a bad Christian or something like that. But I think that's what Paul was talking about. It makes sense since Paul said in 1 Corinthians that he speaks in tongues more than anybody he knows. So, and yet he says, I never do it in public. Therefore, it was a part of his prayer life is the only way you can really understand that. But the Spirit helps us in that effort. 1 Thessalonians 5:17 says, pray without ceasing. Prayer should be something that's an ongoing conversation with God as you go through your day. Obviously, it's important. James 5:16 says, the effective, fervent prayer of a righteous person does a lot of good, avails much. So, I mean, and that's an interesting verse, too, because it seems like there's fervency has some sort of, and Jesus tells some parables to illustrate this as well in Luke, but it's the idea that if you're going to pray, pray seriously. Pray like you really want it. Be passionate in your prayer life. It's so important. But it's one reason why praying with other people isn't as effective as being by yourself. Because if you're praying with other people and you just start, oh, my God, please, you know, you're falling apart. It's like, what? But you can do that between you and God. You know, I do that sometimes. I'm walking on the beach or something, and it's like nobody sees what I'm doing. You know, if I see somebody I know, I'm like, yeah, allergies. But then I ask for forgiveness, 1 John 1:9. But it's like, no, pray and mean it. Be serious about it. It actually avails much. For a lot of people, they just think prayer doesn't do much because God's sovereign. He's going to do what he's going to do, and whether we pray or not, it doesn't matter. But James tells us, you have not because you ask not. There are things that God wants to give us that he can't give us because we don't pray for it. Now, there blows up your Calvinism, but it's just true because the Bible says it. I believe it, and it's important. Philippians 4:6, where in that great, the fourth chapter, well, the book of Philippians is amazing. The whole fourth chapter is just priceless. But, you know, he says there in verse 6 that be anxious for nothing. Don't have anxiety in anything, but in prayer and supplication with thanksgiving, let your requests be made known to God, and the peace of God that passes all comprehension will guard your hearts and minds in Christ Jesus. What an amazing promise. You feel that you are getting anxiety, you take your things to him, he cares about them, and you lay it out before him by prayer and supplication, just really appealing to him and thanking him for everything, which Paul tells us is important to do too. And then he says, the peace of God is coming. You just have to wait for it and it'll come. And it's not like, okay, I have perfect peace now. But if I am taking these things before God, I will sense a peace that I didn't have before. I will feel, you know, it's not a miracle cure to anxiety. There are all kinds of factors that can contribute to anxiety. But what he's saying is, don't just settle for anxiety. I want prayer to be a part of your life, to look for that peace in the middle of your anxiety. And again, not as a cure-all. It's not like that. It's not magic. It's God. It's a relationship. And so Paul says, make sure you do that. He isn't saying that if you have anxiety, you must have not prayed enough. But he's saying if you have anxiety, you should certainly pray. You should make sure that letting it go to God and receiving whatever peace he will give you, he's not a trained SEAL who just does exactly what you tell him to do. But at the same time, that should be our first stop, not our last stop. Now, just a word about, I have here group versus individual. Worship in the Old Testament was corporate prayer. When they prayed together, it was going through the Psalter. singing the Psalms, worshiping God together. And yet still, in the Old Testament, there were the greatest prayers were always private prayers. The irony is, and I really love this, is that most of the public prayers, which were the Psalms, and they were actually the private prayers of David to a great degree, but also Moses and others, and they took their own personal prayers that were private, and they published them so that everyone could share in that conversation with God. There are some people who are more gifted than others at putting words together. There are people who have written words that I go, that says it better than I could ever say it. So that's how worship worked in the Old Testament. There were gifted people who put beautiful content together, and then everybody got to participate in it. Now in the early church, in Acts 2:42, it says that the church, after 3,000 people got saved, and it said they devoted themselves continually to the apostles' teaching, to the breaking of bread, to fellowship, and to prayer. Or literally, in your Bible probably puts a footnote, the prayers, because it's plural and there's a definite article ahead of it. What they were doing in the early church was not just, okay, you know, I'm going to pray for my sister-in-law. Okay, then I'll pray for, you know, the president, and I'll pray. No, that wasn't what it was. It was a formal worship. And that's why it doesn't say they devoted themselves to the apostles' teachings, breaking bread, fellowship, and prayer and worship. Hey, worship was a huge part of their services, but the way they worshiped was to take the word of God, to take those psalms and say those prayers together, because it would express the desire of their hearts. And so, you know, that's what the early church did primarily. But the apostles, all of them, spent lots of time in prayer. But again, it was primarily in their individual prayer life that they would do it. You see, you can learn so much about prayer if you just go through all of Paul's letters and look at every one of his prayers and kind of cut and paste them and look at it together. It's really amazing, not only how he prayed, but what he prayed. A lot of times our prayers are like, we're praying for stuff that nobody in the Bible ever even thought of praying for. Paul even didn't tell Timothy, oh, you got a sick stomach? I'm praying for you. He goes, just take a sip of wine. You'll probably feel better. And, you know, but at the same time, any prayer is better than no prayer. So I'm not knocking trivial prayers where you're praying for a parking place at Walmart or something. That's fine. You can do that. But when you have the power of God at your disposal, don't make that. Don't make your prayer life basically that you keep asking God to bless the pizza. You know, go a little deeper than that. But my point is, the vast majority of praying, Old and New Testament, is personal and private. It isn't, we got to get everybody together and have a day of prayer where everybody's praying. Again, I'm not against a day of prayer. We have a prayer meeting on Wednesday nights. There's nothing wrong with that. Understand this, in the Bible, there were, you know, in the book of Acts, you had a prayer meeting in Acts chapter 1 in the upper room. But it's because Jesus told them to go there and wait. They were playing dice to figure out who the next apostle would be, and Matthias won, you know, the apostolic idol at that point. We still don't know if he's considered the 12th or if Paul is, but, you know, and so they're like praying, and then the Holy Spirit fell on them. But that's one example. The only other real example of a prayer meeting is in Acts chapter 12 when Peter was in prison, and they got together at a house, and they were praying for him to be released. Amazingly and incredibly, an angel came and released him from prison. He went to the prayer meeting, and they wouldn't let him in because they thought it was a ghost. They thought Peter's still in prison. So I don't know if it's the greatest example of, boy, when God's people get together and pray, where two or three are gathered together, great things happen. And by the way, when it says two or three are gathered together, it's not talking about a prayer meeting at all. It's talking about the leaders of the church agreeing on how to administer church discipline. But again, not against prayer meetings. I go to them regularly. But at the same time, if all of the praying that you do is with people, and you don't get by yourself and do the hard work of prayer, you're missing out on everything that you could have in this relationship with him. But it takes discipline. It's something that you have to force yourself to do. But forcing yourself to do things that are really good for you, just like pushing yourself away from the table instead of having an extra dessert or something, it takes discipline, but it's good for you. And there's such a payoff. Why would someone not want to do that? Now, other spiritual disciplines, I listed some. I hope they're on your outline too. You can think about. But giving is something that God commands us to do, to give regularly. Now, nobody really wants to give usually, but it's a discipline. I think the reason why God tells us to pray, for instance, is because we don't like asking for help. And so the discipline of prayer forces us to humble ourselves and ask for help. I think the reason why we don't read the Bible is because we tend to think that we know everything already, and we're not humble enough to just go, I need something brand new. Instead, we look at a Bible story and go, I've read that, I've heard that 100 times, I already know it. At the same time, giving is something that we become so attached to our stuff in an idolatrous way. We love money so much that what we need to do sometimes is to give as a discipline, just to go, I'm showing you that this stuff doesn't own me. Fasting is another one. We love to eat. So the Bible talks about, it assumes that we will periodically fast and pray. And I could go on and on about that forever. But again, it's like, I like to eat. So sometimes as a discipline, I don't eat. And, you know, that's certainly a spiritual discipline because God tells us to do that. Some of the others I have listed here, solitude and silence and ministering to the poor and actually your marriage, the kind of discipline that it takes to, you know, love your husband or your wife and submit yourself to them and work with them. It takes discipline. It's not, I had a couple come in for a marriage counseling appointment this week, and I'm like, they look familiar. And then I realized, I think I married them like 3 weeks ago. And, you know, but that's the way it is. And I had to tell them what you tell everyone. Sometimes you just have to suck it up and do what it takes to make a marriage survive. And it will get better always. But it takes discipline. It takes humility. I've probably told you this before, but on Chuck and Kay's 50th anniversary, I was in their office, and I go, Chuck, 50 years of marriage, what have you learned? And he goes, well, he said, the first 40 years were really rough. And he said, then we quit trying to change each other. And the last 10 have been great. So I always tell people, don't wait 40 years before you stop trying to fix each other. Just accept each other. But that takes discipline because your spouse is different than you are. They're, you know, for me, one area where this was the case is Ann can be pretty forgetful. She's very ADD. So I got used to people calling me at work. Hey, did you know your garage door was left open? And I'm like, oh, my tools, my motorcycle, my, you know, go home and close the door. And that happened for a while. And then I'm just like, you know what? Maybe I'm just going to lose all my stuff. But I'm not going to lose my wife because of my stuff. And I just quit, you know, telling her. I thought I was helping her, but she's like, you sound like my dad. And I'm like, okay, so I just quit saying it. You know, it's amazing. She never leaves the garage door open anymore. I do have an app on my phone where I can check, but seriously, I've never used it even once. She closes the door. She used to leave her purse wherever she would shop, and then she had to call 10 different stores to figure out where her purse is. And I'm like, your ID is in there, credit cards. Me nagging her as I was going through a dumpster trying to find it or whatever, it never helped. But I can't remember the last time she left her purse at a store. It's you have to discipline yourself. Just shut up and realize your relationship is worth more than stuff. But that takes discipline. Eventually, it becomes second nature, just like prayer, just like fasting, just like anything else. But marriage is a real test. And you do the things that you need to do to make a marriage work. And it turns out it's something that really glorifies God at the same time. It's something that God uses a person who is different than you to teach you things about yourself that you could have never seen any other way. So all of these things, and I'm sure you could think of more, there are things that we do that God says, do this, because it'll really be good for you to deny yourself, to do something that you don't naturally do, something that you don't naturally feel like doing. Of course, having kids, you know, there's a bunch of stuff you have to do just because you have a kid. And that makes you grow up. That makes you learn to take more responsibility, notice things more. It also, I mean, I think one spiritual discipline is to play and have fun. And you know, as your kids get older, then it takes your grandkids coming along to teach you that you can play, you can have fun. But at first it's like, I mean, when Sadie and Brandon are at our house, first thing Sadie, Papa, 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 let's play. What do you want to play? You want to play race? Do you want to play hide and seek? And I'm like, yeah, my back's killing me. I'm tired. It's been a long, but I always do it. And it's just plain discipline. And yet, it's so good for me. It turns out that having a race with her or playing hide and seek with her or whatever is actually healthier for me than for me to just come and flop down and be left alone, which is what I would really prefer. That's what my flesh would want. But sometimes it's like to get up and actually do something. That's what discipline is all about. So let's take our salvation seriously. Let's work it out and take it very seriously. Work it out with fear and trembling, because God is working every day, every moment. God's doing something in our lives, but it's only going to be through discipline, like reading the Bible and meditating and praying and all these other things, that we really receive the benefits of being able to work with Him on us. Let's pray. Thank you, Lord. This stuff is so necessary for us and so practical. And we can find hundreds of verses that talk about all of these concepts, because you've made it very clear. And you're so patient with us. But help us not to just sit there and be saved. Help us to actively participate in our relationship with you and work it out, take it seriously, do what you tell us to do, so that we can become more and more who you want us to be. In Jesus' name, amen.